Okay, let us start our last session for this day. The speaker is Sandro Mirighetti, and he will talk us about, tell us about radio properties of the mode switching pulsar BO943+10.
Good afternoon. I started into X-ray astronomy in the mid of the 80s, and I grew up with the idea that rotation power pulsars are basically the only steady, non-variable sources in the very variable X-ray sky. And I've been with this belief until recently, actually. But I will show you that things are changing. Indeed, there have been discovered recently a few exceptions to this rule. Some isolated neutron stars showing X-ray flux variations. One example is this X-DIN, in which you see here flux variation in the soft and in the hard X-ray flux, and indeed this is a time of about 10 years, and you see that the temperature is changing, but we believe that this kind of long-term variation are in some way related to some kind of magnetically powered activity. Indeed, these kind of objects are believed to be the descendants of magnetars. Another example of variability in X-ray rotation-powered pulsars are the bursts that have been observed in a couple of high B field objects. You see these very short bursts resembling those of soft gamma ray repeaters and anomalous X-ray pulsars, coupled to an enhanced X-ray emission. Again, this is something that occurs in a rotation-powered pulsars, but is probably related to, again, some kind of magnetar-like activity. On the other hand, in the radio band, there are a lot of phenomena, very different phenomena, which are possibly related, in which we indeed see variations in the flux. And here are just a few pictures to show you things that you know already very well. These are examples of pulsars that show in the radio band nulling. They disappear for several periods. We have pulsars that in the radio band show a so-called modal behavior. They alternate between two or even more states in which their properties change. For instance, the average radio pulse profiles. We have pulsars that switch off for long periods of time, and during the switched off period, also their period derivative changes. There are pulsars that show a kind of bimodal behavior in the spin down, and again, this kind of variability in the radio properties correlates with radio emission. These are curves in which you have in each plot something which is related to the shape of the pulse profile, and you see that it correlates with the variations in the spin down rate. So there is a lot of variety of variability in rotation power pulsars seen in the radio band. And question that we are trying to ask is the following: are these changes something that is related to something in a sense minor that occurs just at the sites of particle acceleration? After all, in the radio band, we know that only a small fraction of the available spin-down power is emitted. Or are these changes related to something more global that involves the whole magnetosphere, as, for instance, the changes in spin-down seem to imply? And maybe now we are at the point in which X-ray observation can start to tell something relevant in this respect. So this basically was my introduction, and now in the following I will concentrate on these rotation power pulsars, which is the first, or possibly one of the few X-ray valuable pulsars. First, I will make a summary of previous results, and then I will concentrate on the results of the new campaign on this object that we had in 2014. So, this is an ordinary pulsar. It has timing parameters that place it in the bulk of the normal pulsars. It is not a strange beast in some strange place of the PP dot diagram. Okay? It has a typical dipolar field of a few 10 to the 12 Gauss and a characteristic age of 5 million years. What makes this object very interesting is that it is one of the so-called mode-switching pulsars. It alternates between two states, a so-called bright and a so-called quiescent state. This is the paper reporting the Pushkino telescope radio observation in which this bimodal behavior was discovered. You see, these are the average pulse profiles. In the bright mode, it is brighter in radio. It is fainter in the so-called Q mode. And during the B mode, it shows a very regular pattern of drifting sub-pulses. Okay? And X-ray emission from this object was discovered by our chairman in 2003. It is a very rather faint X-ray source. With this data, there were basically too few photons to be able to detect pulsations, and even the spectrum was not constrained very much. It could be fit either with a black body or with a power law, and in both cases you see that the parameters were not very well constrained. The important advance came thanks to a coordinated campaign of observation in which XMM were used together with simultaneous radio observation by Wim Hermsen and collaborators, and this allowed them, first of all, to get more data in X-rays, but also to analyze the data separating the mode of the pulsar based on the radio data. And what was discovered was a very surprising result, that indeed the X-rays are variable, and they vary in anti-correlation with the radio emission. The fact that this is a rather faint source means that these results are best obtained if you use non-standard analysis technique, and in particular all the results that I'm going to present, and also the results that were presented in this paper, were done with the maximum likelihood analysis method. And you see here that the pulsations were detected when the source was in Q mode, while pulsations were not detected in the B mode, and you also see the difference in the X-ray flux between the Q and the B mode. Okay. Concerning the spectrum, the spectrum was rather well measured during the Q mode, which is the mode in which the pulsar is quiescent in radio but brighter in X-rays, and the spectrum was not surprising in a sense, the sum of the black body and the power. This is quite common in middle-aged pulsars. The spectrum in the fainter B mode was not so well constrained. It could be fit equally well by either a power law or a black body. The interesting result that was obtained was that going back to the Q mode data, if you divide the pulsed emission from the non-pulsed emission, I mean, if you extract the spectrum just during the pulsation, you can measure the pulsed spectrum, and the pulsed spectrum turned out to be compatible only with the black body. Okay, so to summarize these results, we have the total spectrum in Q mode, which is a black body plus a power law. The pulsed spectrum in Q mode, which is a black body. And if I take the power law fit to the B mode, fainter state. It was very interesting to see that the power law that fits the B mode and the black body that fits the pulsed flux in the Q mode are within the errors consistent with the two components that are used. This is dead. Can I have a better pointer? Can I have another pointer? Yes. With the two components that fit the total spectrum. Okay. So this led to the suggestion that that what causes or what happens when the pulsar changes mode is that there is always some constant emission, which is a non-thermal emission. And when the pulsar gets brighter, this is due to the appearance of a pulsed thermal component, which is present only during the Q mode. Okay. And this, of course, is very interesting because it seems to require something quite drastic to happen in these objects. You have a new component that suddenly appears or disappears when the pulsar changes, switches between the two different radio states. And also, it is puzzling because we know from radio observations that this object is a nearly aligned rotator, and we are looking at it from direction which is not far from the rotational and magnetic axis. So we should be always seeing a hot polar cap. So we expect first that the pulse fraction be rather small if we are always seeing a polar cap. And it is also difficult to imagine that this hot spot in some way suddenly appears and disappears. Okay. So to try to better understand this object, we got more data. And we got a large program with XMM Newton, and we had, of course, again, simultaneous observation. We had to use radio telescopes in Europe and in the States in order to have a continuous coverage of the X-ray data. This is one example of one session. We had seven of these long observations. These are the radio data in which you see the different modes, QB, QB, and these are the light curves derived with the maximum likelihood analysis from the X-rays, in which you already can see that indeed the source changes its flux correlated to the radio modes. So which were the main results of this new campaign? First of all, from the timing point of view, now, thanks to the longer observation and much higher statistics, we were able to see that also in the fainter B mode, the pulsations in X-rays are present. And we could measure the pulse fraction as a function of energy for the B mode. They are rather steady within large errors, while in the Q mode, the pulse fraction increases with energy. From the spectral point of view, for what concerns the Q mode, again, when the X-ray flux is higher, we basically confirmed the black body plus power law model that was already fit to the previous data. The same data can also be fit with a combination of two black bodies of different temperatures. For the B mode, and now thanks to the longer observation, we can see that the power law is ruled out, and a good spectrum can be obtained only with the black body. Of course, we can add also a power law to this black body. It is not strictly required from a statistical point of view, but both a single black body or a combination of black body and power law are consistent with the spectrum of the B mode. And then, the next step, thanks to an extension of the maximum likelihood method, in which we use the we called it a 3D maximum likelihood, in the sense that besides fitting the data in the spatial coordinates, we also introduced the phase dependence of the flux. Okay, so in this way, we can simultaneously extract the spatial and temporal information, and if we can do this for different energy channels, we can extract simultaneously the pulsed and unpulsed spectra. And in this way, we found that the pulsed flux in Q-mode is fit by a black body. This is the red spectrum here. The unpulsed flux is fitted with a power law. These are the residuals. If I try the opposite, so if I try to fit the pulsed spectrum with the power law and the unpulsed one with a black body, the residuals show us that this is not a good fit. For the B mode, again, we can fit the unpulsed flux with the power law and the pulsed with the black body. The residuals are very good. In this case, also the opposite fit would work, so we could also fit a thermal black body to the unpulsed and the non-thermal to the pulsed. The residuals are shown in this bottom panel. Okay. But since we see in Q-mode a pulsed thermal component, we think that it is more reasonable to assume that also the correct description of the data in B-mode is the same, rather than thinking that completely different components appear and disappear. So to summarize again, these are the two spectra, and what you see here is the in black, you see the total spectrum in Q mode, which is a black body plus a power law in Q and B. And the red and the blue components show you the results of the phase resolved analysis, in the pulsed and the unpulsed spectra. And their sum is consistent with the total spectrum in Q mode. So basically, the bottom line, the result is that the most plausible interpretation of this data is that both pulsed black body and non-pulsed power law are present in both modes, and both components vary when the pulsar changes the states. This is interesting to compare the properties of the thermal emission. You see that there are quite large errors in dimension of the hot spot and temperature, but it seems that a change in temperature over at a fixed area is favored. In any case, the size of the emitting cups is rather small, smaller than the classical size that you would expect for a polar cup in a dipolar geometry. Another interesting result is this one. We try to see, to look for some evidence of variation during the modes as a function of time. And this was motivated by the fact that indeed there are properties of the radio emissions that are seen to evolve during the B mode. Okay? And the only thing that we could find is that if we take the B-mode data and we take just the initial parts of the B-mode, so the first 3 hours of the B-modes, and the last part of the B-mode, means after 3 hours after the mode switch, it seems that the pulse fraction increases. This is results at the 2-sigma level, but is possibly interesting based on the fact that we know that something also happens at radio wavelengths. And this fact could also explain why the pulsations were not detected in the old data, because in the previous data, most of the time intervals in which the pulsar was in B mode were rather short. We did not have a good coverage of the latest part of the B mode. And this might explain why the pulsation in B mode were not detected. Another thing that we checked is to try to see the time scale on which the transition occur. And of course, with the statistics of X-rays, we cannot go to the single pulses as is done in radio. But by stacking all the transitions from Q to B, we have 15 of them, and 12 transition from B to Q, we get these light curves in which it seems that we don't see any evidence of resolved variation in the flux. But the beam size is only 15 minutes in this kind of light curves. We cannot do better with the current instruments. I will skip this and go to the conclusions. So basically, the important point I want to make is that indeed the rotation power pulsars can show variability. We are just at the beginning of this kind of results. I think that this is a very promising new tool that can help us to maybe understand better also how the radio emission is produced in these objects. And we will hear more example of this in the next talk by Wim. Concerning O943 in particular, the main conclusions of the new data is that both radio modes have basically the same kind of spectrum in X-rays, composed of a thermal and non-thermal component, and it seems that the pulsation are to be ascribed to the thermal X-rays, which is still something that needs to be explained. And both these components vary in a correlated way when the pulsar switches mode. Okay? This suggests that there is some kind of causal relation between the thermal and non-thermal X-rays, which is something not unexpected. You can imagine possibly that you accelerate particles in the magnetosphere to produce the non-thermal X-rays, but some particles are also accelerated backward on the polar caps and contribute to heat the polar caps and causes this relation. And the fact that the mode transition is not associated to a single component that appears or disappears, maybe has some implication also for the kind of question that I was asking at the beginning. So is this something global or something local that happens in these mode switching pulsars? But this, again, is something that it is not easy to answer. I'm sure that there are different possibilities to explain this kind of results. I think that that's all I wanted to say, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Sandra. Questions, please. Oleg?
Sandra, isn't it a little unnatural that the emission is brighter during the radio quiet mode if indeed there are some particles that appear, you know, and they produce higher non-thermal X-ray and heat the surface? Shouldn't it be during the radio bright?
What you're saying is only partially correct. This terminology, bright and quiescent, is very misleading in a sense. I mean, it is something of historical. It is true that X-ray flux, the radio flux, is higher during the B mode, but what we see in the radio pulses is just is not a complete view of what is really happening in the radio emission. You know.
Okay.
And so it is not really something related to the brightness or to the luminosity of the object.
Yeah. So then to follow-up sort of questions. So one is it possible maybe to model it with a different model, like an absorption variable absorption feature, like broad absorption feature, instead of trying to component black body plus power law? And Do you know on what time scale, when it switches from Q mode to B mode, the X-ray emission changes in flux? Is there a delay compared to switching in radio? Or
we cannot tell. We cannot tell this. All we can say on the rapidity of the mode switch is that it occurs within 15 minutes. We cannot say more with the current data. And concerning the different kind of modeling, what we see is, I think, from the spectral point of view, more naturally explained in terms of different components than in terms of absorption. It is difficult to think two kind of absorption that works at all energies. I mean, we see that both the power law and the black body are changing in the two modes. No, it does not work. You need to change the flux in both components.
But if you just change your model from black body plus power law to absorption feature plus black.
Absorption feature. You must invent an absorption feature that keeps the same shape of the spectrum. Yeah, I mean you can, but it has to be a very broad feature, and then this introduces much more degrees of freedom. Remember, these are faint sources. I mean, this is a result of maximum likelihood spectral extraction. We cannot play too much with the models.
Okay, more questions? Yeah, good.
Have you new radio observations synchronous with your X-ray emission or only X-ray, new X-ray? Observations, or with radio observations, new radio observations synchronous with this?
No, the radio observations used during the XMM observation were simultaneous with the XMM observation.
When?
This was November 2014 for the latest results, and it was 2011, again October-November 2011, for the results published in Hermsen et al. 2013.
Mm-hmm. Other questions? Ali?
Thank you. Two questions. First, has there been a systematic search for X-ray variability in most of the variable radio pulsars?
Most of them, actually all of them, are fainter than this one.
Okay.
And the best candidates, of course, have been looked at after these results, and you will hear about that in the next talk.
And the other question is, what are the X-ray luminosities corresponding to these count rates?
A few tens to the nut. 10 to the 29 Hz per second.
10 to the 29, thank you.
So the efficiency is quite normal because the spin down power of these objects is 10 to the 32 Hz per second.
Okay, more questions? Matthew?
Matthew there.
Sandro, since you raised the possibility of return current heating of the polar cap, this is a very small polar cap size. So what constraints can you get from the pulse fraction on the polar cap size and the inclination angle?
This is another part of the puzzle because independent of the size of the polar cap, if you believe that the angles that are deduced for these objects from the modeling of the radio emission, it means that it's a nearly aligned scene polon, it is difficult to explain such a large fraction with thermal emission unless you invoke some particular beaming or some different geometry for the magnetic field. To try to get a constraint, I think that any constraint you can get on the size of the emission regions is going to be very model dependent. Of course, if instead of the black body you fit with an atmosphere model, you immediately get larger radii. Okay. still quite smaller than the dipole polar cap. If you want to interpret this as evidence for multipoles near the polar caps, it's up to you.
Okay, thank you.
Any more questions? No more questions. Okay, then let's thank the speaker again.